This is Dr. Joan Tallis, the United States planet Earth. Do you read me? Is anyone out there? Let's try another channel. Hello?
To the cosmonaut. He's the first man ever to go into space. So he goes up in this big spaceship, but the only habitable part of it's very small. So the cosmonaut's in there, and he's got this portal window, and he's looking out of it, and he sees the curvature of the Earth. First time, you're the first man to ever look at the planet he's from. And he's lost in that moment. Thank you.
rather slow spacecraft that is also known as the Interstellar Ark. It is its own kind of alternative to spaceships that fly at much higher speeds and have traditional crews. But just how realistic is this? And will the time come when mankind will accomplish these kinds of voyages in real life? Thank you.
Chief, I understand.
Being so well informed, you'll easily find the control center.
Thank you.
to touch the face of God. Thank you. considère comme plus que probable non seulement la présence d'une vie végétale et animale dans l'infinité de l'univers, mais celle d'êtres doués d'intelligence. Le professeur Hermann Oberth, le père des voyages interplanétaires, nous a dit « Je crois possible que des êtres inconnus et étrangers, doués d'une intelligence supérieure, aient visité notre planète dans un passé fort lointain. Les hommes de science opposent trop facilement une attitude négative aux idées nouvelles. Lorsque le chemin de fer fut inventé, n'ont-ils pas prétendu que l'être humain ne supporterait pas une vitesse de plus de 30 km à l'heure ? » Le savant russe Kazantsev, membre de l'Académie des sciences de Moscou, affirme « À la question de savoir si des êtres extraterrestres, doués d'intelligence, ont un jour visité la Terre, je répondrai par l'affirmative. » À l'Académie des sciences de Minsk, le docteur Vyacheslav Saitsev a déclaré « Je suis personnellement convaincu que des créatures extraterrestres sont venues sur notre planète, et j'en suis convaincu à cause des nombreuses traces qu'elles ont laissées derrière elles. Nous n'avons pas encore appris à interpréter ces traces. » Ce n'est qu'à partir du moment où nous allons nous-mêmes vers les étoiles que l'idée d'un très ancien contact interplanétaire avec la Terre devient concevable.
minus 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10. We're go for main engine start. 7, 6, we have main engine start. 3, 2, 1, and liftoff. Liftoff of the shuttle. And the crew tries to retrieve the return satellites from space, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
Mission Control. well with the EVA, preparing to do the flight check with the Stinger on the MMU.
Okay, now, where am I? No, wait, don't do that. No, I'm going to back up. Can I just back up? I go forward for a little bit. Okay, pitch down so you can see where you're at. Okay.
Go a little higher, just so you can clear the tail.
Don't want to get too close to the airline.
Okay, a little higher. I got about 6 feet to take you to the Stinger.
Talking to?
I'm sorry, just talking to Joe.
I thought you were going to tell me I was about to ram me.
No. Okay. Joe, translate forward a little bit, please.
Still. Wow, look at that.
Houston Discovery, the sun is up and we're ready to go.
Roger, copy that, David. We're ready also.
Things are proceeding very well at the EVA. The crewmen were holding up. They're waiting for daylight to illuminate the satellite in the orbiter's cargo bay, so they'll have good lighting conditions for the docking maneuver. Mission specialist Joe Allen on the MMU with a Stinger attached to the front will fly around to the back end of the orbiter and insert the Stinger into the rocket nozzle. The used rocket nozzle of the Palapa satellite, and he'll then trigger the toggle bolts and tighten the grip on the satellite. The mechanical arm operated by mission specialist Anna Fisher will then grapple a connecting fixture on the side of the Stinger, and then we'll haul the satellite and Joe Allen attached to it back down toward the cargo bay, where Dale Gardner will attach an A-frame structure to the top of the satellite that will enable it to be grabbed by the mechanical arm from the top and then inserted tail down into a retaining fixture in the cargo bay, where it will be firmly mounted for the return to Earth.
Okay, I'm lined up pretty well behind it. Into it. But the sun's in a nasty position. My closing rate's about right. Okay, I almost can't see it. I'm flying right into the sun.
Yeah, I'm gonna do that.
Okay, stop. Easy going.
SETI, S-E-T-I, stands for the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. It's a word that describes a wide variety of different kinds of searches which are being made all over the world for evidence of the existence of other civilizations in space. Almost all of the searches that are being done are being done with telescopes. Our goal is to detect those searches. Radio, radar transmissions from other civilizations. The first result comes from us simply the knowledge of other civilizations exist in space. That, of course, would be an enormous milestone in history's best view of civilization. Why do we search? It is because everything we know about our universe, about our planetary system, and about the origin and evolution of life on Earth seems to say that all of these things were the result of completely normal processes that occur in our galaxy. No special phenomena, no freak events required for our civilization to exist as it does. Given the enormous number of stars in our galaxy, like the sun, it follows that there should be many, many civilizations in our galaxy and in other galaxies. If they practice technology as we do, they are detected. This is a recent development. Until a few decades ago, our instruments were not sensitive enough to detect reasonable manifestations of intelligent life. That is, they could not detect the same sorts of signals and power levels that we ourselves radiate. However, we have crossed an important threshold in that we have developed instruments which can detect signals no stronger than we radiate across the vast distances which separate the stars. In fact, our present radio telescopes, if used properly, can detect Earth-like signals all the way from the far side of the galaxy. Therefore, it is reasonable to search. There would be an enormous intellectual payoff for the detection of other civilizations. Their mere existence is a very important fact which will influence our thinking, our philosophy, our outlook on life. We will learn almost certainly facts of science, evolution, biology, and other places, not learned by any other means. We would see what prospects there are for the future of civilizations, what becomes of them, how do they manage their resources, what ways of life do they adopt. All of these things are interesting in their own right. At the same time, they provide very useful information in developing their own resources.
Not traced as yet the development of
molecules of life, but not the first of those things.
But we are close to that.
And
again, I guess it seems to be any special
circumstances required to arrive at the
thing. Once you have living things, they compete for resources.
Very complicated organisms will develop. Many ways. Looking at the history of our own creatures, one thing which is always true, the ability of
designing the Arecibo message and other messages, we always try to put it to describe also.
Thank you. Yeah.